questions. How can you measure up to deserve affection, to ever be enough for this existence? When did it get so hard? Your heart is beating, alive and breathing, and there's a reason why. You are essential, not accidental.
I got somebody coming in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hi.
Where's the camera? Hey guys.
Hey.
I miss y'all.
Hey.
Who we got?
We got a lot of people.
We got a lot of people. Yeah. Cool.
Hey, Bubba. We got that's for the YouTubes.
Say hey. Oh. Say hey. I miss y'all.
Hey, Graham. What does a bear say?
Bye.
Oh. Yeah.
All right, tell him bye.
Say bye bye.
Can you blow him kisses? Say I miss you. Bye y'all. Have fun.
Now y'all probably want to leave now since they're leaving, but whatever. Y'all can deal with me for about 20 more minutes. It'll be okay. Cool. Anybody want to open us up in prayer? I hadn't heard Brady open us up in prayer in a very long time. So I think just for nostalgia and as a celebratory, you know, getting things back open, I think Brady should open us up in prayer. Is that cool with you, Brady? All right, go for it, dude.
Thank you for this day. I thank you for everything that you've given to us. I thank you for all the rain we're getting, dear Lord. And I pray that it won't flood, even though we do thank you for the rain. And I pray that you'll give us a good week this week, dear Lord, and I pray that the virus will just slowly drift away, and I pray that you'll just be able to start phase two on Friday, and I pray that you'll just give us a good summer this summer, and pray that everything will be able to be open back up soon, and I pray that you'll just give us a good lesson tonight. Please give Neil the words to say, and just please give us all a safe night. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Cool. Thanks, man. I didn't realize how much I missed a good old Brady Kilgore prayer. I love those. Those are always on point, dude, and I appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, cool deal. All right, Cody, you want to hit the podcast music? I'm just kidding. That just gets me to talk.
Okay.
Just kidding. We'll hit the jingle later.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, last week we talked about, you know, there's going to be a new normal, things like that. We kind of, you know, have been talking about like current event stuff since all this craziness has been going on. And to like feed off of what we talked about last week, I kept thinking about the word essential. You know, we've heard of that word since like February or March, right? I've lost track of how long this thing's been going on. We've heard that since forever. We've heard that word essential. And so what do you think that word essential means? Anybody?
You're important.
Important. What else?
We need it.
It's needed. Who else? So just blurt it out loud. Important, needed, anything else? All right, yeah, so those are two really good adjectives for that, is, you know, important, needed, things like that. But, you know, that's also turned into a thing where it's made people not feel important or not feel needed, right? So that's how that's happened as well. I'm sorry, I keep getting distracted. I'm trying to, you know, unmute when I want to hear from y'all and mute when, just to kind of cut out feedback and whatnot. But getting back to what I was saying, essential, important, needed. But, you know, in this time, in this uncertainty, in this pandemic, some people have been labeled non-essential, right? They've been labeled, you know, you're not important enough to keep your job right now. You're not, you know, you're not needed. So just go home and file for unemployment, and hopefully you might get some money sooner or later, right? But, you know, that can really take a beating to somebody's, you know, like mentality, to their confidence, that, you know, what I'm doing doesn't matter in a time of crisis. That, you know, that wouldn't bode well for some people, right? Thankfully, I got to keep working. Yeah, grass keeps growing during a pandemic too, so I got to keep working, right? Some people didn't. Like people that work at like a clothing store, they either lost their job or their pay got delayed until they opened back up, and maybe they opened back up phase two. I'm not sure. But they were labeled non-essential, right? And so that really just got me thinking about, what does the word essential mean to not just human beings, but to, you know, in the eyes of God and in scripture and things like that. So that's why I label tonight's lesson essential. Spoiler alert, newsflash, in the eyes of Christ, in the eyes of God, we're all essential, okay? And I'm going to show you that in scripture tonight. So let me get my notes pulled up. All right, so this first one, you know, let me get to the one in Genesis first, just to start off at the beginning, just for a little basis. So Genesis 1, start verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, all over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish and of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." I could just stop right there and say, bye, but no, I'm not going to. That's enough, you know, that says right there of how essential we are in God's eyes. He made us in his image, okay? God made me, God made Cody, Brady, Amber, Shelby, Savannah, all of y'all, everybody on this earth, he made us in his image. That's basically, I could say, enough said, we're important because he made us in his image, right? But let's keep going a little bit. Let me see what else I got right here. Let's look at Romans 5, starting verse 6. "For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly." That's us. For a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Now, if you're grown up in church, if you have, you know, just really good common knowledge of scripture, a lot happened. A lot of bad stuff happened, but a lot of good stuff happened between Genesis and Romans, right? So, yes, God created us in his image. But by the time we get to Romans, you know, we didn't even get out of Genesis before we committed the first sin, right? So from Genesis on, we have been sinners. We were born into sin. You know, as the day we were born into sin. But like it says right there, but God demonstrates his own love towards us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. So not only are we essential enough to be created in God's image, but we're essential enough that God sent Jesus Christ to die for every single one of us. Another one. Let's see. Let's go to Matthew real quick. This is during the Great Commission, okay? So, it said, you know, in Romans it said Christ died for us. It didn't say Christ died, you know, just for people that make a certain amount of money or just for people that have a certain job. Us means all. Christ died for all. And in the Great Commission, Matthew 28, starting in verse 18, "And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations.'" He wants all of us to be disciples of him, "baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. And I'll say amen too, just because that's awesome. So not only did he create us in his image, not only did he send Jesus Christ for all, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, all of us. He tells his disciples in the Great Commission to go to all nations, make disciples in all nations. He doesn't want just a certain, you know, ethnic group to be his disciples. He doesn't want a certain group that wears a certain, you know, article of clothing to be his disciples. He wants all nations to be part of his journey, part of his, you know, the disciples. And this one right here, we've gone over this before. So you think, yeah, you know, God created me in his image. Jesus Christ died for me. He's told us to go to all nations and make disciples, right? But I just don't feel like I fit in. I don't feel like I fit in with the youth group. I don't feel like I fit in at church. I don't feel like I fit in at school. We all have a place. We all have a purpose. We are all essential. Just like we were talking about, you know, when all this stuff started shutting down, things were labeled non-essential and those jobs just ceased to exist for a little while. People were out of jobs and, you know, some people are still waiting to get money that they were promised from government due to unemployment. But this scripture right here in 1 Corinthians tells us we are all essential. We all have a role. So 1 Corinthians 12, verse 12. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body. So also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into the body, into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all have been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. You know, like our, just like our bodies, right? He's talking about, like, you know, think of a body. Your body's just not one single body part. We have different body parts, right? So verse 15, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would it be the hearing? Plus, that would look super scary if we were just a floating eyeball, kind of like Mike Wazowski or something like that. If the whole body were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God, hold on just a second, something popped up. We don't need to upgrade Zoom. We're keeping that free stuff. But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed, there are many members, yet one body. So we're all members, but yeah, we all serve the same purpose. We all serve the same within the same body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you. Nor again, the head to the feet, I have no need for you. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. But our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. So some of us, you know, in terms like this, some of us are hands. Some of us are the eyes. Some of us are the mouth. And, you know, in studies past, we kind of broke this down a little bit more, but I just wanted to bring it back up because it, you know, this shows right here that we are all essential. This shows right here that we all have a purpose. Some of us are feet. We get on the ground and start going. Some of us are hands. We reach out and serve. Some of us are mouths. We further the kingdom with our mouth. We go out and speak, right? Some of us are ears. We hear people out. We're here to listen to them. And some people are the eyes. But think of it, like I said before, like a football team. who would catch the balls if everybody wanted to play quarterback? Who would throw the ball if everybody wanted to play wide receiver? You need different parts to be of the same team. You need to have different roles to serve that one purpose. Excuse me. But we are all essential. So don't think that just because, you know, you don't raise your hand much in youth group, or, you know, you don't say much or respond much or things like that, that doesn't mean you're not any more or less important than the person that wants to read all the time or say a prayer all the time. I'm not saying like anybody in particular. I'm just saying like as an example. We all have different roles in the body of Christ. We all have different roles, not just at Midway Baptist Church, but we all have different roles as the church as a whole, because we are the church. You know, we haven't been in the actual building for almost 2 months now. So if the church was just a building, it would just be an empty building for 8 or 9 weeks. We are the church. We have been the church through this whole time. It's been a little different how we've been doing this. And, you know, watching y'all on the screen and, you know, having little delays here and there, and doing things on YouTube and whatnot. But we have still been the church. We have still been that same body of Christ with our each little roles that we've been doing. We are all essential. Don't ever think you're not essential. Sometimes we're told, oh, you know, you messed up, you're not essential anymore. That's a lie. We can never move. God will never move. We move back and forth. We have to remember that we are essential. We are important. God has called us here for a purpose. Okay? And with that, I'll finish up. I'm going to stop the YouTube video, and we can hang out for just a little bit. So let me tell the YouTube. Bye.
Bye. And go with me.